out, please. Order, all.
I'd like to welcome everyone to our annual memorial service to Captain Henry Works, sponsored by the Alexander H. Stevens Camp, Sons of Confederate Veterans. At this time, I'd like to ask our camp assistant chaplain, Paul Mott, if he would please come forward and open us with an invocation.
Pray with me, please. Lord, we are gathered here today to remember and to honor those who fought so bravely in the war that divided our nation some 150 years ago, and especially to remember Captain Henry Wirz and honor him, Lord. And we know that he did everything that he could possibly do under the circumstances to provide for the men and the prisoners that were under his command. And we just thank you for him, and thank you for all of those who so gallantly gave and were so brave in this battle. We ask you, Lord, to help us never forget our ancestors, not only these, but the ones that came before and the ones that came after, that allow us, Lord, to live in this great nation in freedom and liberty, with the right to assemble in a place like this, Lord. And help us always to remember, Lord, that it all comes from you. And to you be the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please remain standing and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag and the salute to the Georgia flag and the Confederate flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And a pledge to the Georgia state flag. I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag and the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation. And now the salute to the Confederate flag. I salute the Confederate flag with affection, reverence, and undying devotion to the cause for which it stands. Thank you. You may be seated. We're delighted that everyone has turned out today. We have a beautiful day today, again, to observe Captain Henry Wirz Day here in Andersonville. My name is John Carroll. I'm the commander of the Alexander H. Stevens Camp in Americus. And at this time, I would like to welcome forward the mayor of Andersonville, Marvin Ball, to read a proclamation. Mayor Ball.
Just in case anybody wants to know, this day was ordered by the citizens of Andersonville. And along with that, welcome, enjoy yourselves, and come back as many times as you like. Whereas the unqualified loyalty of Captain Henry Wirz to his adopted Southland declared by reason of the following facts. One, he voluntarily enlisted in the 4th Louisiana Infantry in June 1861. Two, he gave his right arm in the defense of the Confederate capital at the Battle of Seven Pines, 31 May 1862. Number three, his manner of performance of duties was such as to earn promotion in the Confederate service from private to sergeant to captain and assistant adjutant general on 12 June 1862, and recommended for major, which was approved too late in 1865. Number four, his important assignments included assistant adjutant general in charge of prisons, ambassador of President Davis for special task in Paris and Berlin for 13 months. The commandant of the consolidated prison at Andersonville from 27 March 1864 until paroled with the Army of Tennessee upon surrender on 26 April 1865. And number five, his heroic refusal to plead bargain for his life for his testimony against Jefferson Davis, whose destruction was deeply desired by vindictive radicals. Whereas, the tragic trial of Captain Wirz was unconstitutional in its origin and supremely irregular in its conduct. Note is given to the following. The judgment of Northern historian Bruce Canton: Wirz was a scapegoat dying for the sins of many, North and South, and of the National Observer in a six-column full-page article carrying a handsome portrait of the Confederate major with the title Captain Wirz, Confederate Martyr, 8 November 1965, the 100th anniversary of Wirz's execution, which was 10 November 1865. Now, therefore, I do hereby proclaim November 9th, 2014, Captain Henry Wirz Day, this ninth day of November 2014. Thank you.
Mayor Ball, we thank you once again for presenting that proclamation, and we thank you for helping the Alexander Stevens Camp and the Sons Confederate Veterans host this annual event. The City of Andersonville has always welcomed us and assisted us in everything they can do with this special occasion each year, and we certainly do appreciate that each year, Mayor. At this time, we're going to have our main speaker. Is that correct, James? We put the speaker before the greetings this year? Good. He changed up on me a little bit, threw me a curveball, so I had to check with my man in charge to make sure. Our speaker this year is known to many of you. He is the commander of the Sons Confederate Veterans Camp in Albany, Georgia. James King was born in Tifton in 1947. He was raised in Irwin and Tift counties on small farms. He attended ABAC and the University of Georgia, where he graduated with honors and received his Bachelor of Science and Master's degrees in Agriculture. After graduating, he was employed by the Georgia Cooperative Extension Service in 1971 as a county agricultural agent in Worth and Calhoun counties. He also started a part-time business buying and selling antique, classic, and collectible firearms. That part-time business turned into a full-time business in 1990, and he continues with that business today, specializing in firearms such as Winchesters, Colts, and Sharps, which most of us are familiar with. He and his wife, Melanie, have seven children. As I've stated, James is a member of that Albany camp of the SCV since 1988, and he served as their camp commander since 2003. He has many ancestors that served in the Confederacy, as well as descendants from the South, notably in Virginia and North Carolina, who served in the Revolutionary War and the War of 1812. Mr. King is a staunch American patriot. He's committed to the principles of the American Republic established by our American founding fathers, who were primarily Southern gentlemen from Virginia, and he is dedicated to preserving our Southern Confederate history, our heritage, and our culture. Let's give Commander James King a warm welcome to Andersonville.
Ladies and gentlemen, first I'd like to thank Commander Carroll and the
America's chairman of the Works Memorial Committee, James Gaston, the Muckalee Guards, and all the members of Camp 78 for the great job that they do putting on this Works Memorial Service each year. Let's just take a moment and give them a standing ovation. It is entirely fitting and proper to honor a Southern Confederate hero and martyr, an innocent man who was made a scapegoat by irrational and inflamed Northern sectional hatred and ignorance. The facts that I will present today are derived from three sources. The Gray Book, published in the 1930s by the Sons of Confederate Veterans, addressed many of the charges that had been claimed wrongly against the South. Second is a book that America's Camp sells that was written in 1920 or 21 by Ms. Mildred Lewis Rutherford, historian for the United Daughters of the Confederacy, and this book is available from the camp here. And third, here's 87 pages by the Southern Historical Society, printed in March 1876, the treatment of prisoners during the war between the states. And the Southern Historical Society was formed in 1868 to 69, and they have done a tremendous job of compiling facts and information. They have letters by Robert E. Lee, Jefferson Davis, Alexander Stevens, most all the high-ranking people of the Confederacy, and letters from Northern politicians and military people. And the facts that are presented in these three documents prove that the suffering and deaths at Andersonville are virtually 100% due to the cold-blooded attitudes and policies of the Lincoln administration and Yankee Secretary of War Edward Stanton and Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana and General Ulysses S. Grant, and the conditions and circumstances were beyond the control of the Confederate States of America. The information I present today will be divided into two segments. First, the story of Camp Sumter, generally known as Andersonville, and then the second will be the farce trial of Commandant Captain Henry Wirz. Andersonville, on June the 3rd, 1863, General Order 207 by the Confederate States of America government ordered that a large prison be constructed far south of Libby and Belle Island POW prisons in Virginia. On November the 27th, 1863, Captain William Sidney Winder was sent by his father, Brigadier General John Henry Winder, to select a location. And the location chosen was here at Andersonville in Sumter County in southwest Georgia, far from the war front in Virginia. Construction began January 1864, 17 acres, a stockade, barracks were to be built later. The requirements were that the area have a running stream with pure water, be at a healthy location, close to grist mills and sawmills, and have shade trees if possible. Proof that the human disaster at Andersonville was virtually 100% the fault of the Lincoln administration, Stanton, Dana, and Grant. There were 9 points that this 87-page document of the Southern Historical Society put together, and as I said, they did a tremendous job with the research putting all these facts and information together. Excuse me just a moment. I have an allergy, and I occasionally have to take a sip of water. Point number one, it is not denied that suffering and deaths and circumstances and conditions beyond the control of the Confederate States of America occurred here at Andersonville. Second, if the death rate is circumstantial evidence of barbarity, then it also indicts the North. About 9% overall of Northern POWs, Union POWs that were held in Confederate prisons died, and it was 12% in the North. 12% of Confederate prisoners died. But, of course, conditions that I'll discuss in just a moment made the death rate much higher here at Andersonville, but again, it was not the fault of the Confederate States of America. The other thing was that the Confederate government required that Union prisoners of war be given the same rations, the same food, the same meals as the enlisted men in the Confederate States Army, and they were to receive the same hospital treatment. Now, the North did not have this humane policy, and Confederate POWs in the North were not, there was no attempt to treat them in that manner as it was in the South. The next thing, exchange was refused. Wirz even went to the effort to parole POWs from here in Andersonville, and they were sent to the Union lines to plead for assistance and so forth. But that assistance was denied. We have the statements from Union POWs stating James Madison Page and a number of others. I have their quotes here where they verified that the conditions and what happened here at Andersonville was not the fault of Captain Wirz. It was not the fault of the Confederate States government or any officials within the Confederate States government. They knew that it was the fault of the Northern Lincoln administration, particularly General Grant and Secretary of War Dana and Secretary of War Edwin Stanton. It was said by James Madison Page that daily you could see Union POWs here at Andersonville shaking their fist and cursing those Northern politicians and military leaders that kept them detained and would not exchange them. The next point was that the Confederate States of America and Captain Wirz and General Winder requested that the North send doctors and medicine to treat their own people. This request was denied. They requested that they be able to buy supplies and particularly utensils to feed all these prisoners. Originally, Andersonville was designed for maybe 10,000, but it swelled to the ranks of about as much as 45,000 because the North refused to exchange prisoners. And they had, can you think about how many bowls and utensils it would take to supply food to this many people? They tried to buy utensils to feed the Northern POWs from the North. They tried to pay for it with gold, cotton, and tobacco, and the North refused to sell them supplies to help their own people. The Lincoln administration made medicine contraband. Even in World War II, the Nazis and the Imperial Japanese, nobody had declared medicine contraband, but the Lincoln administration did, and they refused to supply medicine to help treat the prisoners here at Andersonville. And prior to the greatest mortality that occurred here at Andersonville, Colonel Ould, who was in charge of exchange, tried to get the North to take the prisoners without any exchange, and they were refused. They refused even without any exchange, just to take them and come get them. They didn't do that. I'll read right quick a letter of Colonel Gould, Ould, pleading with Union General Mulford of the U.S. Army for an exchange of prisoners. He said, "My government instructs me to waive all formalities in this matter of exchange. I need not try to conceal from you that we cannot feed and provide for the prisoners in our hands. We cannot half feed or clothe them. You have closed our ports till we cannot get medical stores for them. You will not send us quinine and other needed medicines, even for the exclusive use of these Northern POWs. They are suffering greatly, and the mortality is excessive. I tell you all this plainly, and still you refuse to exchange. What does your government demand? Name your own conditions, and I have authority to accept them. You are silent. Great God, can it be that you people are monsters? If you will not exchange, I will give you your men for nothing. I will deliver 10,000 Union prisoners at Wilmington. I will deliver 5,000 here on the same terms. Come and get them. If your government is so damnably dishonest to want them for nothing, yes, you shall have them. You can at least feed them, and we cannot. You can give us what you please in return for them." Of course, this was, you know, they allowed the prisoners to die here during this period of greatest mortality. And this was during the time that Sherman's barbaric war crimes here in Georgia were taking place, stealing, burning, and destroying. People were starving. And so the North should have had reason to understand that what he was doing in Georgia was making supplies even worse, and it was harming not only the military and civilians of the South and the state of Georgia, but it was causing this death rate and suffering of the Union POWs. At point number nine, the Northern press continued to feed lies and propaganda to the Northern press to keep the Northern people inflamed with hatred, to keep the war effort going and so forth. But Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana admitted after the war that it was not the Confederate States of America that was responsible, that it was the North that was responsible. And he went so far as to say Jefferson Davis or Captain Wirz should not be blamed for what happened at Andersonville. It was our fault in the North. And this is the Union Federal Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana saying that. He admitted that what happened at Andersonville was not the fault of the South, the Confederate government. It was the fault of the Lincoln administration and the federal government in Washington, D.C. Now, we'll move on to the trial of Captain Henry Wirz. Captain Wirz was born 1822 in Zurich, Switzerland. He came to America, joined the Confederate Army in Louisiana, and he was wounded at the Battle of Seven Pines, Virginia, early in 1862. It damaged his forearm, which there's a photo that is still in a museum in Maryland, I believe, now. But he was sent to France and Germany as a special minister, and he stayed there 2 years. But on about April the 12th, 1864, he was commanded by Confederate President Jefferson Davis to take command of the interior of Andersonville here, Camp Sumter. And as I've already stated and everything, he did all that he could to help those prisoners. He had squads of them that did their own cooking. He let groups of them out to gather firewood. It was said that he walked among them unarmed, that the Northern prisoners, I think it was James Madison Page, said that he had seen Wirz with tears in his eyes because he couldn't do any more for them. Because he got blamed for being a barbarian and for everything, that he was a scapegoat for everything that happened at Andersonville. After the Confederate States surrender, he was paroled, taken to Macon, Georgia. General Wilson said that everything was in order with his parole, but another officer showed up and he was taken to Washington, D.C., put in the old Capitol prison. He was charged with war crimes and conspiracy and convicted. It was a farce trial. It began in September 1865. Only two other trials in English and American history come to my mind that were such a magnitude of this, to this extent, that was such a farce trial and a travesty. The first in England, after the English Civil War of 1642 to 1649, Oliver Cromwell put King Charles I on trial with all types of false charges. It was a farce trial. He was beheaded in 1649. And the next travesty and farce trial that comes to mind occurred here in America after the end of the war. Lincoln was assassinated. Ms. Mary Surratt was accused of being a party to that, and she was hung, the first woman hung in America. Captain Wirz was convicted on perjured testimony. The man that was the key witness, he claimed to be Felix de la Baume, and he claimed to be a great nephew of Marquis de Lafayette of Revolutionary War fame that had assisted George Washington with the victory of the Revolutionary War. It turned out that he was Felix Osher, born in Saxony. He had never been to Andersonville, but he was an intelligent man, and he was very articulate, and he described all these atrocities that he had seen Wirz commit. But as I said, it turned out later that some soldiers from New York recognized him 11 days after Wirz was hung. They recognized that the key witness had committed perjury and never been at Andersonville. Judge Advocate N.P. Chipman was head of the military tribunal. He subpoenaed numerous people and so forth, but the way he handled this is what, like I said, was a farce trial, or what we call a kangaroo court sometimes. He did not allow most of the people that wanted to testify defending Captain Wirz to testify. One of the people was Colonel Ould, that was the Commissioner of Exchanges that I talked about a few minutes ago. He came and had a subpoena, but Colonel Chipman, the Union Judge Advocate, took his subpoena away from him and voided it. So he did not let many of the people that wanted to testify in favor of Captain Wirz testify at that trial. But the night before Captain Wirz was hanged on November the 10th, 1865, he was offered a commuted sentence if he would implicate Jefferson Davis as being a party to what happened at Andersonville. Wirz was an honorable man. He would not lie to save his life, and he died on at 10:32 a.m. on November 10th, 1865. And then, insult to injury, the barbarian Yankees cut off his body parts. They decapitated him, cut off his arms and legs, and displayed them at various places in the North, and I suppose charged the fee to see them. And this picture here of his forearm, I understand, is still in the museum in Maryland or whatever. But it took his defense attorney, Mr. Slade, 4 years to get the government to get enough body parts returned to even have a Christian funeral. And he's buried in the in the cemetery in that area up there. And this is the story of what occurred. This is the story of Andersonville. This is the story of what happened to Captain Wirz, that he was made a scapegoat for the South. And as I said, the Southern Historical Society, if you read this whole 87 pages that they documented, letters, as I said, letters from Jefferson Davis, Robert E. Lee, Alexander Stevens, letters from Northern military men, Northern politicians, including Assistant Secretary of War Charles Anderson Dana, and the testimony of all the Union prisoners that were here at Andersonville, I don't see how any rational person can come to any conclusion except that Wirz was an innocent man who was made a scapegoat. He was not a war criminal. He was hung, and it's a shame and travesty on the American justice system. But as I said, after the war, in the New York Sun newspaper, Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana said this: CSA authorities, and especially Jefferson Davis, ought not to be held responsible for Andersonville. We were responsible ourselves for the continued detention of our captives in misery, starvation, sickness in the South. All I'll say about the Northern prisoner of war camps, the things that took place there, the death rate was higher. It was about equal, almost equal in camp at Elmira, New York, and Camp Douglas at Chicago. The death rate of Confederates was almost equal to what occurred here in Andersonville of Union POWs. But the torture, disease, malnutrition, and exposure to weather in Northern prisons was intentional. And that's proven because the United States Senate and House of Representatives passed a joint resolution, SR 97, that stated that it was their deliberate intent to kill Confederate soldiers by exposure to inclement weather, disease, starvation, and so forth. So that's I looked that up on the internet and found the date that the U.S. Congress made that resolution. So it's a fact. In 1906, former Confederate General Stephen D. Lee charged the Sons of Confederate Veterans to see that the true history of the South was presented to future generations, and that's what I am working toward doing myself, and y'all are. Long live the South, long live Dixie. May we never forget.
Commander King, we want to thank you for your presentation today, very informative. And that's what we are here for today, is to make sure the true history of the South is preserved for future generations. Many of you were aware that we had invited Senator Paul Brown to be with us today. Dr. Brown, unfortunately, had to cancel on us at a late hour, and we were fortunate to have Commander King today step up and be able to make his presentation today in Senator Brown's stead. We certainly are blessed today to have many distinguished guests with us today on a special occasion, and we would like to ask some of those at this time to come forward and bring greetings from their respective organizations. First, I'd like to ask Ms. Sybil Willingham, the Georgia Division Parliamentarian for the United Daughters of the Confederacy, to come forward. Ms. Sybil.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John, and thank you to the gentlemen of the Alexander H. Stevens Camp 78 for your invitation to be with you today. I bring greetings on behalf of the Georgia Division, United Daughters of the Confederacy, and offer our gratitude for your efforts to keep the memory alive of Henry Wirz. As Commander King said, he was a true hero. He was an honorable man who, like all Confederates, did his duty when called upon. His trial, conviction on false testimony, and his hanging rank as low points in American history. When offered his life and freedom, if he bore witness against Jefferson Davis, he refused, and he met his fate with dignity. He became the embodiment of the hatred for the South that had been festering for years. They were not just hanging Henry Wirz, they were hanging the Confederacy. In 1910, the Georgia Division, UDC, placed here the monument commemorating his life, service, and death. It was one of the first major projects undertaken by the Georgia Division, UDC, and it was their statement, literally carved in stone, of the truth of Andersonville and the valor of Henry Wirz. They thought that it was important then, and it is still important today, 100 years later. Thank you for continuing to remember the life and service of a true Confederate hero, an American hero, and to commemorate the anniversary of the wrongful death of Henry Wirz. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Willingham. I also like at this time introduce Ms. Alina Nitterite. She is the custodian of the Children of the Confederacy Georgia Division.
On behalf of all the kids of Georgia Division Children of the Confederacy, I bring greetings. Please enjoy.
Thank you, Ms. Nitterite. Our Commander-in-Chief of the Sons of Confederate Veterans, Commander Kelly Bear, unfortunately had a death in his family this week. He is usually here every year, and he could not be here this year because of that death in his family. And we would, at this time, like to make a special presentation that Commander Bear was to make, and I will make it for him. The Sons of Confederate Veterans, for the last several years, has had a special presentation and achievement certificate that it presents to all members of the Sons of Confederate Veterans who attain the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America. We admire the ambitious goals of young people who had to have the intuitive spirit to be able to earn 21 merit badges and to stay in Boy Scouts long enough to earn its highest rank. Out of approximately 100 Boy Scouts or young men that joined the Boy Scouts, I believe the statistic still stands that only two of those will attain the rank of Eagle Scout. So it is quite an achievement. As a part of earning an Eagle Scout award, The young scout must participate in a community project, a community service project. And many of these scouts do this in conjunction with another organization as a part of their community. Several times, our local camp has sponsored Boy Scouts in projects of historic nature that help them earn their Eagle Scout. And so today, we have one such scout with us and his father, and I will ask them to come up at this time, compatriot John C. Waller and his father, William Waller. We've literally watched John grow up in the Sons of Confederate Veterans, because when his father, William, first joined the SCV, he was a member of the Alexander H. Stevens camp. And William used to bring John to the meetings when he was a little baby. And I can remember that to this day. Sometimes he was a little fussy, but that kept some of us older guys awake, right? So we can appreciate that. But today we're here to recognize Eagle Scout John C. Waller, and I have this presentation to make to him. Eagle Scout John C. Waller has earned the admiration and congratulations of the Sons of Confederate Veterans for achieving the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America. His achievement is the result of many years of dedication and hard work. In order to become an Eagle Scout, he has challenged himself to do his best for his God and his country. Through scouting, he has learned to live his life by practicing the same values and morals which Confederate soldiers cherished. Presented on this 19th day of October, which is when this certificate was signed by Commander Barra, under the hand and seal of the Commander-in-Chief, Sons of Confederate Veterans, I do present you this Sons of Confederate Veterans Eagle Scout Achievement Certificate. Congratulations. Thank you. Before they sit down, just let me tell you what compatriot Waller's project was. They live over in Terrell County in Dawson, and he undertook a project where he put Confederate Southern crosses on all the graves, the Confederate graves, in Cedar Hill Cemetery in Dawson.
How many crosses? How many crosses were erected?
About 130 crosses. So he had to raise the funds to do that, and the Sons of Confederate Veterans assisted him with that. And then he had many hours of labor with himself and other scouts involved in order to put those crosses on over 100 Confederate graves there in Dawson, many of which were not marked as Confederates. So let's give John Waller another round of applause for his hard work. You can stand if you want to.
Congratulations, Will. Congratulations.
Yep. He wants to get a picture.
One, two.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our Military Order Stars and Bars Georgia Commander David Denard. Is David here? David must not have been able to attend this year. David is usually here each year, and we appreciate his support. Next, we have our Sons of Confederate Veterans Georgia Division Commander, Michael Mull. Michael, will you come bring greetings?
Thank you, Commander Carroll. It's indeed a pleasure to be here in Andersonville. Last time that I was here, I participated in the reenactment, which was held kind of down behind the village there. Commander Carroll's being a little bit modest. He didn't tell you that in addition to being the commander of the camp in America's Camp 78, he is also Lieutenant Commander South, which means he has a big responsibility in looking after all of the camps within the southern section of the state. To assist him, we have 9th Brigade Commander John Fisher back here in the back. I see John back there. Raise your hand. There you go, John. Good to have you here. On behalf of the Georgia Division Sons of Confederate Veterans, I welcome you here to Andersonville, because it's events like this that bring our history to the forefront. That is one thing that we must not do. We must not let our history fall to the wayside. It's a good day to be in Andersonville, and it's a good day to be in Dixie. Thank you.
Thank you, Commander Moore. And you took my order of program there. Thank you.
Don't worry about that.
That's okay. You're just trying to test me, right? All right. At this time, I'd like to ask our Works Chairman, James Gaston, to come forward, and he has a letter to read from the great-grandnephew of Captain Henry Wirz, Colonel Heinrich Wirz.
The pretty red and white flag over here to my extreme left is the flag of Switzerland, and Colonel Heinrich Wirz calls that the sister republic to the United States. Before I read this letter, I would just like to say I appreciate everyone turning out. This is certainly a wonderful turnout today, and the Lord has just blessed us wonderfully with this beautiful afternoon. I have been coming to this since its inception 39 years ago, and I think only two times have we had to meet inside. So the Lord's just blessed us again today, and I'm mighty grateful for that. This letter from Colonel Heinrich Wirz, ladies and gentlemen, dear Confederate compatriots and American friends, please let me briefly inform you on three projects concerning Captain Henry Wirz, my very unfortunate great-granduncle. Firstly, the documentary, secondly, the Swiss in the War of Secession, and thirdly, the parts of Captain Wirz's skeleton on exhibition in the National Museum of Health and Medicine in Silver Springs, Maryland. Previously, I mentioned the thorough research work is in progress on Henry Wirz in Europe and the United States. The final objective is the source documentary, which contains a profound examination of the trial of 1865 in Washington. The brochure on Swiss in the War, translated in English, is estimated that between 4,000 and 6,000 soldiers of Swiss origin served in the Confederate or the Union Army. We've been able to find and identify over 100 officers, including six generals, two of which were Confederate States Brigadier Generals. And then number three, you may have heard of the controversial issue on the body parts in the National Museum of Health and Medicine in Maryland. One opinion is to retrieve these parts, the right forearm and the first two neck vertebrae, for reasons of decency and religion, and have them buried in the existing grave at Mount Olivet Cemetery in Washington, D.C. The opposite conviction is that as long as the bones are exhibited in the National Museum, the name, the trial, and the cruel treatment of Captain Henry Wirz and his body remain obvious to the American public in favor of a possible later verdict of not guilty. His descendants in both countries, United States and Switzerland, want to avoid the, quote, out of sight, out of mind, or to put it in Swiss language, far from eye, far from heart. So what he's saying is they do not favor taking these bones out of the museum at the present time and burying them because they are afraid that people will forget Captain Wirz at that time, out of sight, out of mind. Finally, I thank all of you for being here today to remember the tragedy of a Southern martyr and hero. My special thanks go to guest speaker James King, Memorial Service Committee Chairman James Gaston, SCV Camp Commander John Carroll, and to all others involved in this ceremony. God bless our two so-called sister republics, the United States of America and Switzerland, in the heart of Europe.
James, we appreciate those words and those sentiments from the Wirz family. At this time, I'd like to recognize all of our guests here in attendance today, and we have quite a few of you here, some special people that I would like to recognize if you were here. Miss Peggy Shepherd, for many years, Miss Peggy has been Miss Andersonville, and she used to never miss this occasion, and I'm not sure she's here today, but I never want to fail to mention her name, and we do appreciate all she's done for the city of Andersonville and for us as Sons of Confederate Veterans, and we certainly extend Ms. Shepherd our love and affection this year. Also, to no lesser degree, Miss Cynthia Stormcaller. Cynthia, I saw around here earlier while we were starting together. She's also been very helpful in helping us organize and setting up each year and on this day especially. And we want to also thank her for all her efforts. Mr. Leland Park from Davidson, North Carolina. Mr. Park was one of the members of the Sons of Confederate Veterans who was a founder of the annual Captain Works Memorial Service James mentioned 39 years ago. And we also want to thank him. We have with us today our State Representative Mike Chokas from Americus. Mike, congratulations on your recent reelection. Let's give Mike a round of applause. We appreciate your support. Appreciate your support and hard work in the state capitol. We also have with us State Senator Greg Kirk. Greg, please stand up and be recognized. Greg, we also want to congratulate you on your recent election. And thank you both for your service in our state capitol for all that you do for us. We have with us today also represented from our Andersonville National Historic Site, Mr. Eric Leonard. Eric, we appreciate all you do, and we look forward to our continued cooperative relationship with the National Park Service. They recently had a new superintendent assigned to the National Park. Brad Bennett went up to Chattanooga Chickamauga State Park. We'll miss Brad. We had a great relationship with Brad while he was here, and we look forward to continuing that relationship when the new superintendent arrives. Already been recognized, but I'll recognize him again, our SUV 9th Brigade Commander, John Fisher, back in the back from Bainbridge. We appreciate you being here, John, and traveling from Bainbridge today. David Floyd, I haven't seen David, but David is usually here. He's our MOS&B Army of Tennessee Commander. We always appreciate his support.
Commander, I'm Martin Bell from Macon. I'm the editor of the new MOS&B newsletter, the Georgia Guardian. So we are here today.
Awesome. We appreciate your representation. And be sure to get us that newsletter. We'd love to see that. Great, great.
And we got a wreath, too.
Excellent, excellent. We'd be glad to help you present the wreath later during the service.
You've done a wonderful job, everybody, here today. We wanted to thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your presence. Dr. Fred Ruhlman, who wrote a book on Henry Wirz and the trial of Wirz several years ago, did his doctoral thesis on Captain Wirz. I don't see Fred here, but he continues to support this event, and we appreciate Fred's continued work on behalf of Captain Wirz. All of the ladies from the UDC, will you please stand and be recognized? Tell me your chapter name and where you're from. I know I see several here. Right here in the front, we'll start with Ms. Usher.
Georgia.
Thank you for your attendance. Yes, ma'am.
Melissa Mitterwright, Chapter President, Wallace Edwards, 430 Butler, Georgia.
Thank you for being here. Yes, ma'am.
Admiral Sims is Chapter Number 57 in Auburn, Alabama.
Auburn, Alabama. Awesome. Thank you for being here. Ms. Cobb? Excellent. Ms. Carroll? Thank you. Anyone that I missed? Yes, ma'am.
Our former division president, Linda Kennedy.
Ms. Kennedy, we appreciate you being here. Anyone else that I missed? Any other UDC chapters here? Of course, Ms. Willingham here with us on stage. We appreciate the ladies of the UDC and what they have done to help perpetuate the history of the Southern soldier for many years, including this wonderful monument that they erected to Captain Wirz some 102 years ago this year. And we certainly support them and look forward to a great working relationship with the UDC and our joint effort to preserve our heritage. Thank you, ladies, for being here. I see a lot of guys from different SCV chapters. Somebody from each chapter, holler out where you're from. And
Stone Mountain, SCV camp.
Great, Stone Mountain. Where else? Stuart Webster, I see you back there. Commander Cobb. Yes, sir.
John Howell, chaplain, 1614,
Tallahassee, Florida. Great to have you with us. Yes, sir, in the back. Warner Robins camp. Thank you for being here. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Yes, sir, in the front. Moultrie, we appreciate you being here. Anybody else? Commander King's camp from Albany, of course, is here. We appreciate everyone's attention. Anybody? Any? Yes, sir. Several mechanized cavalry units, which is an associate group associated with the SCV. We appreciate all you guys here. Appreciate your efforts. Anyone else I may have missed?
Camp 78,
America. Oh, Camp 78. We're here, of course. And everybody from 78, raise your hand so I can see you. So I won't talk bad about you at the next meeting. Thank you guys for all that you do.
Camp 941 from Statesboro.
There you go, Statesboro. We got guys here from all over Georgia and a couple states, I think. Three or four states, maybe. So we appreciate everyone's support. Go home and tell your compatriots, go home and tell your fellow UDC members about this event and encourage them to attend next year. We have this service as close to November the 10th each year as possible, and next year will be the 150th observation of Captain Henry Wirz's execution. And we plan to have some special events going on next year in observance of that. So keep that in mind. Hopefully, Colonel Heinrich Wirz hopefully will be here. He's planning on coming, Lord willing. I have one quick announcement, and then we'll proceed with Dixie from A Joyful Noise, and then we'll have our procession to the Wirz Monument with the wreath laying, and followed by a rifle salute by our Muckley Guard, Company A of the 12th Georgia, and we'll conclude with playing of taps. James, you have one other thing?
Other recognitions I think you overlooked, but we do have some children of the Confederacy here, I think.
I beg their pardon. All our children are Confederacy members. Y'all, please stand and wave your hand. CSC members, I know I saw a few earlier. Great. Number nine, that must have been in the fold of the page. I sure did. Thomas Holloway, where's Mr. Thomas? He's from owner and publisher of the Sumter News. We appreciate Mr. Holloway being here and giving us great publicity on this event as always. Thank you, sir, for being here once again. If you're not a member of the Sons of Confederate Veterans or the United Daughters of the Confederacy, we sure encourage you to become one. Our local camp here in Americus is going to be having a recruitment event this month on the 18th, November 18th, at the American Legion Hall in Americus. If you're interested in possibly becoming a member, please give me a call or see James Gaston or our camp adjutant, Abner Belcher, back there in the back. We'd love to have you come to that recruitment event where you can learn more about what the Sons of Confederate Veterans do all across the state and the country. And we appreciate you once again being here. At this time, I'm going to ask A Joyful Noise if they will play Dixie for us. Everyone, please stand.
Do it. Richmond had fell, it's a time.